The Guardians of the Galaxy have been disassembled. We don't know where half their ranks are, with Rocket Raccoon missing and Drax apparently dead. Can they reassemble? This is the Comic Storian channel, where I take your favorite trade paperbacks and single issues and I break them down into digestible bites, and then I read them dramatically back to you. All alterations to the panels, text, and images are to prevent copyright problems, and all art is owned by its respective companies. This is a part of the Guardians of the Galaxy 2019 run, written by Donny Cates. After writing Infinity Wars, killing off Thanos, Gamora fleeing into space to get away from everyone, the Guardians were in a bad state, completely disassembled, with apparently only Peter Quill and Groot off in space trying to just be themselves, while they were called back to action as the Guardians of the Galaxy to prevent the revival of Thanos. The Dark Guardians of the Galaxy and the Good Guardians of the Galaxy all dispersed, leaving Peter and Groot with a couple new members, but with the big question of, where is Rocket Raccoon? Out in the deep reaches of space, the Nova Corps gets a report of a giant temple destroyer from the Universal Church of Truth that has just emerged. The command advises that they just received the largest concentration of tachyon energy ever recorded in this or any space sector. As the officers try to figure out what to do, a blinding purple light shines in and a robed man steps out. He tells the Corps to stand down. Be calm. Our path does not concern you, Nova Corps. The officers surround him, telling him that unfortunately it does involve them. They're going to need him and his men to drop their weapons and shut down their engines. The robed man sighs, telling him, it shall be recorded in our world mind that I gave you a chance. Bless you all for your sacrifice. Have faith. Turn on the engine! The guards behind the robed man tell him, have faith. And the officers yell for him to stop what he's doing and... But before the commanding officer could finish, the giant Ankh on the side of the cathedral lights up. Suddenly, thousands of tendrils reach out, grabbing each of the officers as they try to pull back. The commanding officer struggles for a moment, but then smiles. Faith. And begins to lift his helmet. The operator tells him not to do it or it will kill him, and the officer tells him, have faith, and removes his helmet. Meanwhile, over at Dolomion, Dar-Lord sits up in his bed telling him, you know, I gotta admit, I thought you would have taken longer to think about the whole me telling you I loved you thing. Gamora rolls over onto him, telling him, yeah, well, it's like you said, we die a lot. Why waste time, Peter? But just then, there's a knock at the door with Groot yelling that they need to see this. Everyone hurries to the ship, where a recording of Star-Lord's father, Jason, tells him that the Universal Church of Truth has appeared. The Nova Corps was investigating, and now they're all gone. All of them. The entire Nova Corps is dead, Peter. He just ordered the Spartox fleet to get on the front lines, but if their reports are any indication, this might be the last chance that he can say how sorry he is. He'll never be the greatest father. He'll regret it for as long as he lives. But before Jason could go on, the same purple light appears and he yells, don't come here, Peter! I am sorry! Have faith. As the feed ends, Star-Lord flies over to the cathedral, telling everyone to listen up. We're going in. Lockjaw's gonna bring us into that monster while Moondragon stays here and psi-links everyone in case our comms fail. Groot will remain on the helm of our ship with the engines ready to go if we need to get out of there in a hurry. Everyone, get ready to get teleported by the big dog. Lockjaw opens up the portal into the giant temple, and Star-Lord looks at all of the large tubes asking, what is this? Where are we? The robed man from before tells him that this is the engine room of the cathedral, and you are welcome here. Moondragon says that there is something not right about this guy. Be careful, Peter. Star-Lord pulls up his blaster, telling the robed man, stay right where you are! Where is my father, Jason? The robed man says that they may call him the Patriarch, soon to be the right hand of our resurrected Messiah. I speak on behalf of the Universal Church of Truth. There is no need for weapons here. We are going to save you. Suddenly, the same tendrils that took the Nova Corps shoot out, grabbing everyone. And back on the ship, Moondragon's psi-link is severed. Groot runs over asking what happened, but Moondragon turns to him, screaming for him to run. Back inside of the cathedral, everyone is let go as the Patriarch says, that is enough. What you have witnessed is a glimpse into the future. The end is coming and we are trying to prevent that. It is unfortunate that we must fill our engines to resurrect our Messiah. He who will kill our final foe. He who will slay death. The Patriarch removes his hood, telling him, that is why I sent you the message. I wanted my son to see the glory. As the hood is removed, he reveals himself to be Jason, standing there telling Star-Lord that he must rest. Have faith. Star-Lord tells him no, but as he looks back, he sees everyone else is under the Patriarch's influence. Elsewhere, Moondragon is explaining what happened to Groot, stating that she can still feel their pain. They're all that's left. She doesn't know what his deal is, but he has to help save everyone. A scratchy voice comes out. Yeah, yeah, fine. End of the world, down to cult stuff. Yeah, I'm in. A dying, decrepit Rocket Raccoon pulls the curtains back. I mean, hell, what else do I have to lose? Moondragon telepathically tells Rocket to show her what happened. He tells her to get out of his head. He doesn't owe her anything, and he certainly doesn't owe her an explanation for his situation. She shouts, telling him that that is enough. Their friends, his friends, are in danger. Stop being a coward and show us. And Rocket yells back, fine! You want to see it? You want to see hurt? I was born on Half-World. An intergalactic insane asylum built by some kind of scientist who thought a planet full of crazies was a good idea. I was bred to be a, kind of service animal. Something soft to help calm the patients down. My patient, Kevix, was a war vet with a mouth like a sailor. Liked me to just sit there in his lap and watch old war movies. Kevix, he was good to me. He was the last one who ever was. Later, the scientists that founded the place all left when it got too rough. So they put the care of the patients into the hands of the robotic staff. And the robots gave that job to the animals when they couldn't handle it. As far as the actual process goes, I'll never know. But they altered my DNA somehow, evolved me into something. I always thought that maybe it was like how the Kree made the Inhumans or something. But the truth is it didn't matter. I don't look back and miss being soft. That ain't to say it was all bad. I had a lot of crazy adventures. I was a sheriff, a ranger. I made some friends, fought in a few cosmic wars. Killed a lot of bad people with an aggressively large weaponry. I was a guardian of the galaxy. I had a family. People who are good to me. But whatever was done to me, it's coming undone. My body is shutting down, rejecting whatever modifications they did. I wasn't gonna be taken care of. I wasn't gonna be soft again. So I left. And Groot scoffs. Without saying a word! Rocket begins to pour himself a drink. Where's Peter and the gang? We have a plan, or... Groot stands up and he kicks the table, shouting, How dare you! You speak of family, yet you never answer our calls. You know that Gamora was guarding you, right? She knew that you wanted to die, but she didn't want any of your enemies to kill you first. She was gonna bury you! Rocket asks, Do you really think that I wanted this? And Groot tells him, I don't know what you want. Groot doesn't know you anymore. The Rocket that Groot knew would fight this with everything he had. He would let his family help him. He wouldn't hide like a dying cat or... I was hiding because I didn't want you to see me like this! After everything I've done for the galaxy, don't I at least get that? Don't I at least get to decide how I'm remembered? Groot looks away, and then he turns back. No! You don't belong to yourself. None of us do. We owe it to each other to keep going. Because you won't be there when you die. Everyone else will be. That's what family means. Rocket coughs, walking into the next room. Yeah, I get it. I already said I'd help. And Groot asks, Where are you going? Rocket tells him, I can't exactly go save the galaxy in my current condition, can I? As Rocket opens up the door to the next room, he reveals a large mechanic suit that has some familiar colors. It's a Gundam. Rocket made himself a miniature Gundam. Back in the cathedral, Star-Lord follows Patriarch, asking, Where are they going? What is? But before he could finish, Star-Lord sees several tubes containing many of the galaxy's heroes, and he realizes that it's Quasar, it's Darkhawk. Patriarch says that they'll all live, beyond their life essence powering their drives. They each contain a small amount of trace psychic residue that they need to extract if they're going to kill death in their future's darkest hour. Star-Lord asks, Psychic? Extracting? What the hell does it all mean? And Patriarch tells him, Look, do you see it? This cocoon houses our Messiah, and once he is born, he will kill death once and for all. Star-Lord yells at the church brainwashed him. This is what they do. They always get one of these cocoons, and they resurrect Adam Warlock for some mysterious, stupid reason, and then they get beat. It's always the same, Dad. Patriarch smiles. Not this time. The church has learned. You must have faith. Star-Lord asks, What's so different this time? And the Patriarch tells him, It's not Adam this time. It's not just one. But Star-Lord steps up past the original cocoon to see hundreds more cocoons all waiting to be hatched. Patriarch explains that the universe in their time was burning. There was no heroes, no villains, no life, only ashes, as if the world had been turned off. The oceans boiled, devoid of life under a black sun, and that's when they saw it. High atop a throne of annihilation, there was death. This is the truth, and they must stop it. Do you know how we do that? How do we stop the end of the world? You must have faith. Star-Lord begins to repeat that they must have faith as he's placed into a tube, and the Patriarch says that that's right. They just needed him to understand what they are fighting, what they're prepared to do to change the future, what they must sacrifice to guard the galaxy. He's glad that they can do this together. And Star-Lord, now seemingly brainwashed, I am too. I'm just so sorry. Patriarch asks him, for what? And he looks back to see Star-Lord jumping out of his tube, punching the Patriarch to the ground. He rubs his knuckles, telling him, I'm sorry for that. And as the guards quickly begin to surround him, Star-Lord realizes that he probably should have made a plan before doing something like that. As the guards all begin to rush in, Star-Lord runs towards a closing and narrowly slides under it before the door shuts. He takes a moment to catch his breath, but when Star-Lord looks back, he sees a growling Cosmo and he asks, do I gotta fight a dog now? And Cosmo telepathically tells him, night! As Cosmo psychically attacks Star-Lord, Patriarch walks in telling Cosmo that he is a good boy. They'll take it from here. Meanwhile, on an unknown planet in an unknown sector, everyone fights off a horde of monsters, with Groot yelling, I do not understand why we are here! Rocket fires into the group of creatures, stating, Gamora told me all about this place one night when we were hammered. Groot shouts, you got drunk with Gamora while you were avoiding us and dying? And Rocket says, hey, when a hot, deadly green chick knocks on your door asking for a drink, what's a guy to do? I was dying, but I ain't dead. Moondragon clears another wave of monsters when suddenly she feels something in her head and yells that he's here. Everyone is lifted into the air and a voice tells them to please stop fighting. They mean you no harm. You're just scaring the pets. Rocket looks down at the young Magus, stating, look, buddy, we need your help. Back at the cathedral, the guards throw Peter to the ground, and when he gets back up, stating he doesn't care what they've done to him. There's no way that he'd kill his son. And the Patriarch tells him, you're right. That is why. Behind them, there's a loud crack. And the Patriarch smiles, looking up towards the cocoon, stating that it's happening. It's time. Come along, son. From within the cocoon, the one inside begins to punch his way out, breaking off pieces to free themselves. And the Patriarch yells, this is it, Peter! Behold, our Messiah, our Savior, our Destroyer! And a rage-fueled Drax stands up with Star-Lord asking, Drax, is that really you? And that is the conclusion of this chapter of the Guardians of the Galaxy from Donny Cates' 2019 run. If you want to see the conclusion to this, check back next Sunday as we wrap up the Guardians of the Galaxy storyline. Thank you so much, guys, for sticking around and watching this. Honestly, this is one of my favorite Guardians storylines. It's just so epic on a different level, and it all comes together so beautifully. But you're going to find that out next Sunday if you stick around here at the channel. Overall, guys, thank you so much for watching this channel. I really do appreciate it. And don't forget, our Patreons have already voted that the story that will begin after Guardians of the Galaxy is Batman Inc. So if you want to be a part of the vote for the next Sunday storyline, make sure you head on over there and hit us up.